Hi, today I'm going to be talking Cary Grant. So we're going to be going through my top 22 Cary Grant movies from worst to best. I'm Foxy Cellars. I love the art of storytelling, so please click the like, subscribe. It does help out my channel. Okay, so Cary Grant films. I don't want to say Cary Grant is my favorite actor. He's clearly one of my favorite actors. But there's a very specific commodity to a Cary Grant movie, very different than some of my other favorite actors, like, you know, Marlon Brando, for example, or Gregory Peck or any of those. They fit into roles differently. Cary Grant, there is a very specific movie that's set up for him. And you can even watch a bad Cary Grant movie and you're going to get the charm and the wit and the brilliance of Cary Grant regardless. Now, writing sometimes does help and make his movies better. I'm going to go through the ones that are just both a great movie and Cary Grant is great in them. Now, the interesting thing about Cary Grant is he was one of these actors, came from England. He had a very thick Bristol accent. And when he came to America, he did everything he could to try to get rid of it. He came up with a way to like kind of hide it by doing an impression of an American accent. And this was the character that Cary Grant developed and that audiences fell in love with. Now, he was nominated twice for an Oscar. He was nominated 5 times for a Golden Globe, but he never won any of these. In total, he has 73 films, but I would say 69 of them are more the starring roles. So I'll be focusing on those. And out of all of those, I've only seen 43 of the 69. It's because a lot of the other ones aren't accessible. And none of those 26 that I haven't seen are significant, really. I mean, if I were to look at the list, I've never heard of any of them. So I really feel like I'm getting the meat and potatoes of these. Real quick, some of the honorable mentions that didn't quite make the 22 list was Charade, which is a very popular movie with a lot of people. Audrey Hepburn is fantastic in it. She kind of pulls the weight almost for it. He was a little older by then. Just didn't quite make my list. Monkey Business is another one that's very popular. Not really one of my favorite Howard Hawk movies, so it didn't quite make the list. Oh, and Bringing Up Baby. That's a good movie. It probably would have been 23, 24, so it just didn't make the list. So, I mean, if you are waiting for one of those three, it's not going to show up. So, starting, number 22 is Indiscreet. It's a cute little romantic comedy where Cary Grant's character is the I never want to get married character, which is the character that shows up in probably 92% of his movies. So, again, this is that character. He has this thing where he lies. And he tells people that he is married just to kind of avoid all of the commotion of it. And so when he does this and has a romantic encounter, it doesn't have to follow through because he's already married. Ingrid plays, you know, a lot of games with him. And then there's some mistaken scenarios because, of course, he's lying. And it's cute. It, you know, it's fun. It plays out and it's number 22. Number 21, Mr. Lucky with Lorraine Day. This is in Grant's prime.
If you're so interested in serving a cause, why don't you join the army?
Next, please.
Oh. Four F.
You look 1A to me.
Yeah, you don't look so bad yourself.
It's a very well-written story where he's a grifter and he's trying to avoid being drafted into the war. He charms Lorraine's character, who's like kind of a socialite, into putting together like a fundraiser for the war effort. But he's really just, he's just a con man in it. And, you know, it's got its typical romance, but it's a lot of witty, fun interludes. And it's typical Cary Grant. But Mr. Lucky is one of those films that's on a lot of people's lists. I liked it. It's not as high up on the list for me, but it's definitely, you know, worth mentioning. Number 20. Every Girl Should Be Married. His co-star in this is Betsy Drake. This one's a lot of fun. So this is a young girl who attempts to trick an older Cary Grant into marrying her. It's got a very Mad Men feel to it. And he's, again, this character that I don't ever want to get married. And he ends up changing his ways, of course, during the process of the movie. It's a lot of fun. Number 19 is Mr. Blanding builds his dream house.
Yes, if you don't mind.
And off the kitchen,
I think,
now, a little flower.
Yes, see, there should be a terrace stone off the study floor, with a little awning and an outdoor fireplace.
For vases,
sort of a barbecue thing, you know,
gardening thing.
What do they call
and them? This is one of the cases where his co-star is Myrna Loy. I believe he was in a couple of movies with her. Another one's going to show up on this list. And she's famous for the Thin Man movies. I think she did 5 or 6 of those. You know, the Nick and Nora, and she was Nora in those. So Grant had a lot of really great chemistry with most of his leading ladies. I do think he was kind of the key ingredient to most of those romantic comedies. But with Myrna Loy, it's like a typical building your relationship house, trials and tribulations film. I mean, it's got kind of like that money trap feel to it. And this might have been one of the first films that did this. It's very pleasant. And I do love the chemistry between those two. It's very important. Number 18 is That Touch of Pink. It's one of his later movies. And he was nominated for a Golden Globe for this one as well. He's in it with Doris Day. And this is one of his last really great films. It's got the same ingredients. It's the guy that doesn't want to get married. You know, that common theme that's going to show up again and again. And actually, that was one of his real life attitudes, too. I mean, if there's this TV show that came out, Archie, that follows along Archie Leach, that's his real name. And it follows along his trials and tribulations and, you know, his relationships, his divorces and all that. And he never wanted to have kids. He never really wanted to have, you know, a true type of marriage. And this carries over to his characters in film. Doris Day, in this case, is like the poor 9-to-5 worker who meets her rich Prince Charming. I mean, it's great. It's just another routine courtship film, but he's so great at his chemistry with his leading ladies that it just blossoms. All of these films blossom. You fall in love with him. You fall in love with her. It's just the same thing. Number 17 is Once Upon a Honeymoon. This is one of his earlier films. And this one is with Ginger Rogers. Ginger Rogers is one of the more memorable leading ladies he was associated with. She also shows up in like Monkey Business with him. And I loved their chemistry more so than some of the others. I wish they did more movies together. I'd say they had equal screen presence. He usually had this very dominating screen presence, but with Ginger Rogers, they had an equal screen presence. I know anytime I go through the phase of watching Fred Astaire or Ginger Rogers films, that factor is there because she had that same dominant presence just as she does when she does a film with Cary Grant. Ginger's character in this is she's a status climbing kind of like gold digger. And she marries this, I think I can't remember if he's a Nazi sympathizer or he's a Nazi. What's the difference? And she falls in love with the reporter that's cracking the case of this kind of, you know, scandal. This one definitely holds up and I love these two together. Number 16 is The Awful Truth. This is one of his earlier movies. I believe this is probably the oldest movie I have on this list. He does have a lot of movies from the 30s and a lot of those he hadn't quite blossomed yet. So I think this might be the oldest that's on the list. And his leading lady in this is Irene Dunne. And Irene Dunne, she shows up in 3 movies with him and she has great chemistry with him as well. The Awful Truth shows up on most people's Cary Grant list. This is no different. Number 15 is Crisis. I saw this movie very recently, you know, maybe like a couple months ago. It's one of his more serious films. And there's that dilemma. He, as a doctor, what would you do if you were held prisoner and asked to save the life of a terrible dictator who, if he lived, would probably murder lots and lots and lots of people? So he's forced with that dilemma. This is definitely one of his more serious movies, but it's good. Number 14, To Catch a Thief. This is going to be the first of the Hitchcock movies.
all of the Hitchcock movies that Cary Grant did will show up on this list. This just happens to be the first one at 14th. And this one, he stars with Grace Kelly. It actually would have been nice if he did more movies with Grace Kelly, but I believe this might be the only one.
Number 13 is Destination Tokyo. And this is probably the most exceptional movie on the list that's not powered mostly by Cary Grant. This is another one I saw probably like maybe a year ago. And it's a submarine film. He's not the main character. And he gets top billing, of course, because he's Cary Grant and this movie came out in the 40s. But I'd rather not say too much about the movie or the storyline, except for the fact that, like, you know, he's the captain. And as the captain, when he shows up, he has a lot of dominance. And he's fantastic in every scene that he's in. And, of course, like the ending, he's very prominent in the ending. But there's just... I suggest seeing this movie. There's just a couple of other characters that are as interesting as well. John Garfield's in it. And then like Alan Hale, who's, you know, the skipper from Gilligan's Island. There's a whole bunch of main characters that you get very invested in as you go along. But then, you know, Cary Grant will show up here and there.
All right, here's a good one. Number 12 is The Talk of the Town. And this is a George Stevens movie. And this is one of the two movies that he did with Jean Arthur. Jean Arthur is one of those people where she just has such a wonderful personality that you fall in love with her as soon as she's on the screen, especially as soon as she starts talking. And this is, I believe, like, you know, with the exception of, you know, some of the movies in the 1942 is really, he started to take off and was extremely successful at this point. This one was nominated for Best Picture. And in my opinion, I think Jean Arthur, like, I want to say she outshines him in this movie, but I mean, he's pretty awesome in it. He's a character. He's hiding in this attic at her house, and she's renting it out to this professor, Ronald Coleman, who's fantastic too. Like, all three of them are great. It's just Jean Arthur really, really does shine. And he was recently nominated to the Supreme Court. So he's not supposed to be associating with, in this case, a murderer and I believe an arson who is hiding out in the attic of Jean Arthur. So they meet, they interact, but he doesn't know who he is, and it's got a lot of potential for hilarious scenes, and it will overachieve. In that sense. And oh, here's something. I've never ever heard anybody talk about this, and it blows my mind because I watch this movie all the time. I've probably seen this movie like every other 3 years. The musical score in it, which is done by Frederick Hollander, and he did like Destry Rides Again and Sabrina and We're No Angels. Anyway, the musical score in it, if you listen to it, I can't get it out of my head, but it sounds exactly like the love theme to Empire Strikes Back. And I guarantee you, John Williams, you know, I've talked about John Williams in a lot of my videos. He's very influenced by people before him, and he had to. I mean, if you listen to it, you might not ever get that out of your head ever again.
Number 11 is The Bachelor and the Bobby Soccer. If this film had no plot whatsoever, and it was just like banter and dialogue, it would still make my list. It's got really, really witty stuff. However, it's a great story too. Like, on top of that, it's got a lot of fun scenarios and scenes that occur. I don't think this one would ever get greenlit today if it were proposed. Myrna Loy, she shows up again as she's a judge in this, and Grant is pretending or kind of playing along with Myrna's character's younger sister, Shirley Temple. She's trying to date him, and don't worry, she's not like Shirley Temple that, you know, she's a teenager in this. But there's a lot of these misunderstandings and jokes that occur. I'm not going to go too much into it, but it's funny, it's charming, and it's naughty. It's got some stuff to it.
Number 10 is An Affair to Remember. So this one's just, you know, an all around great movie. Like it's not, I'm not going to emphasize comedy or drama. There's like, it's just a really great movie altogether, however you want to slice it. And if you recall, this is like the ongoing theme in Sleepless in Seattle to kind of recreate the scenes from this, where the final ends, where they're attempting to meet at the Empire State Building. That's all I'll say about this movie. Number nine is My Favorite Wife. And here, Irene Dunne shows up here. This one's a lot of fun. Irene Dunne plays Carrie's first wife, who is declared dead at sea. And before she returns, he marries another woman. And it's a comedy, of course. And there's these crazy situations that, you know, come back and forth. And like, so between the two wives he's legally married to, he also has kids with the first one. So this does stand out as maybe like top three or four of his just comedies in general, in my opinion. Number eight, and here we go. Here's another Hitchcock movie. This is North by Northwest from 1959. This is one of his later movies. His love interest in it is Eva Saint, and it's got James Mason in it, of course. Okay, so when Cary Grant is in a Hitchcock movie, it's automatically a slam dunk. So every single one he's done with him, he crushes it. And I hate to have this one third out of the four of them, but you know, it's that great. So they're all very, very tight. There's something really great about having someone like Cary Grant helping to take the edge off of the tension that Hitchcock creates in his thrillers. And this one plays very well. And following right up with that is another Hitchcock movie. So this would be the third one that's going to show up. So it'd be my second favorite. It's number seven, Notorious from 1946. And he's matched up with leading lady Ingrid Bergman. This is the first of the two films that he's in with Ingrid Bergman. And I believe they were very, very close friends, I think pretty much all of their life. I found this one to be, you know, kind of a great surprise. I would not have thought I would have put it, you know, this high on the list after just seeing it. There's a ton of tension in this. And Ingrid is forced to spy or infiltrate like a Nazi organization. So there's so many of these little moments where she's like about to get caught, and you're like on the edge of your seat, like, oh, and you know, and as the story progresses, Cary Grant's character falls in love with her. And so he's more and more vested in her not getting caught by the Nazis, of course. And this is probably in my top five of Hitchcock movies. So, you know, it's naturally going to fall high on the list for Cary Grant. Number six is The Bishop's Wife. This was directed by Henry Koster. Loretta Young, and I believe this is the only movie he did with Loretta Young. She's very famous from the movie The Stranger, which is a really, really great Orson Welles movie. It's a comedy, but it's not like screwball comedy. It's more like kind of a classy Christmas comedy. It's very, very similar to It's a Wonderful Life, which came out a year before this. And interestingly enough, Cary Grant's agent is the one that optioned It's a Wonderful Life and had him in mind for George Bailey. But it ended up, you know, going to Jimmy Stewart later on. And then they had this role for him. So this one is a little different, but it's exactly the same volume of heartfelt. This story has an angel, Dudley, who Cary Grant's character, who's helping the wife of the bishop and also the bishop himself, so he can write this great sermon that will change the lives of everybody in the community. And like, it's definitely a top five Christmas movie, period. I think it was also remade with Denzel Washington in the 90s. Okay, so now for my final Hitchcock movie that he was in. If you know all the Hitchcock movies with Cary Grant, you can probably already guess it. Number five is Suspicion, 1941. This is one of the earlier Cary Grant greats. And in this one, his love interest is Joan Fontaine. Cedric Hardwicke is in it. This is the last Hitchcock film on the list. So number five, this is the best of all of them. They really could have been in any order. All four of these are really awesome movies, but something really resonated with this one specifically. He's a bit more of a scumbag in this one, and that's a bit out of character for him. Hitchcock creates enough doubt either way, and a lot of ambiguity is created as to whether, like, is this guy a douchebag or not? Like, what's going on? And there could be ambiguity to the circumstances, you know, like, you don't know. But as the movie progresses, you'll form your own opinion. So that's why I really dug this one. Number four is His Girl Friday from 1940. And I think this is the first of the Howard Hawks movies that show up on the list. And his love interest in this is Rosalind Russell. As much as I love the Hitchcock Cary Grant films, there's these two Howard Hawks films are in my top four. They're really impressive. Doesn't mean I like Howard Hawks movies better than I like Hitchcock, but I do like Howard Hawks movies. So His Girl Friday is so important and one of the best Grant films. I grew up watching the movie Switching Channels with Burt Reynolds and Christopher Reeve and Kathleen Turner. And it wasn't until, you know, because I think I saw this movie for the first time maybe a few years ago. And it wasn't until then that I was like, hey, this is where Switching Channels got it from. In fact, like, it's a straight up an adaption of a play that was then made into a movie. And then, like, so His Girl Friday is the second remake. And then, of course, Switching Channels, I believe, is the third. I don't know if they made another one in there. But Rosalind Russell's portrayal of the female reporter Hildy in this is so absolutely iconic. I believe it's what helped shape the character of Lois Lane in the Superman comics, and probably every spunky female reporter ever after that. So it's a great comedy. It's a great drama. It's just a great movie, period. Number three is Room for One More. This is the sleeper film on my list. It's an absolute tearjerker. Betsy Drake plays this mom and wife, I guess, of three kids already. And she visits an orphanage and she decides she wants to help this disabled little boy. And for the most part, he's awful. Like, he's just an awful kid. And it's not till, like, you know, a little later that the arc starts to develop and he joins the Boy Scouts. And that's where this movie really resonates for me, because I was a Boy Scout and became an Eagle Scout. I don't want to give too much away, but the story has a greater purpose once he starts getting the structure of the Scouts. Number two, Only the Angels Have Wings. And this is the final Howard Hawks movie on here from 1939. It's the other movie that has Gene Arthur in it. And Thomas Mitchell is a big standout in it. But the only reason I ever saw this movie in the first place was because I was a huge Rita Hayworth fan and wanted to see her. But she ends up not being that relevant to it. So it's not really a Rita Hayworth movie at all. This is a Gene Arthur, Thomas Mitchell, and Cary Grant vehicle. And it's such an important part of, like, the influence of films to come. Some people say that Indiana Jones was modeled after Cary Grant's Captain Jeff Carter. And if any of you remember, there was a short-lived TV show from the early 80s called The Gold Monkey. And that show was very firmly modeled, more so off of this movie than of Indiana Jones. It's a great adventure drama with lots of romance, and I go back and watch this movie probably every year. And number one on my list, the greatest Cary Grant movie of all times, is The Philadelphia Story.
How about you, Mr. Connor? You drink, don't you? Alcohol, I mean.
Oh, a little.
A little? And you a writer? I thought all writers drank to excess and beat their wives. You know, one time I think I secretly wanted to be a writer.
This is the best. The Philadelphia Story is not just the best Cary Grant film, but it's probably one of the greatest comedies ever written. It really is. So Grant does shine in this movie. Jimmy Stewart has less of a presence, I believe. I mean, he's great in it, but I mean, it's really a Cary Grant and Katharine Hepburn movie more so than Jimmy Stewart's accolades. But he still does the great Jimmy Stewart things that he does. And Katharine Hepburn is, I mean, this is, you know what? This is probably her best movie, now that I think of it. This has some of the best dialogue and bickering in comedies I've ever seen. There's so many little like undertones and innuendos, personal jabs at each other in a lot of these snarky little conversations that they have. And it should be noted as probably one of the greatest scripts of all times. I'll leave you with this. If you've never seen The Philadelphia Story, then this is an absolute must-see. You have to like put it on the list to do this week. It's Cary Grant's best film, and it's maybe one of the greatest films, you know, top 20 of all times. Well, there you have it. Those are the 22 greatest Cary Grant films, in my opinion. I know a lot of you are going to have some that you're like, well, how could you leave that off? Like, put it in the comment. Let's do battle. I want to hear it. I want to thank you for watching all the way to the end. I'm Foxy Cellars. If you would, again, please click the like, subscribe to my channel. It does help out my channel. And again, comment even if you've got an opinion that varies or even you want to solidify my opinion. Thanks again.